Welcome back to Worldview. Now, Robert Hunziker joined us last week and began the top 10 list of absolute climate horrors out there, things that we need to be worrying about and the way our life is going to change if we do absolutely nothing. So let's rejoin Robert Hunziker and welcome back to Worldview.
Hi, Dennis.
In this segment, let's pick up where we left off, which was with number six on your top 10 list, and let's take it from there. What can we expect in the top 10 list is number six here?
Well, number six is unprecedented damage to infrastructure. And I took my lead here really from the world's largest reinsurance company, Munich Re.
Yeah.
And they claim that climate change has contributed to a five-fold increase since 1980 in worldwide weather-related disasters. So that's what they're saying. This is one of the major corporations of the entire world telling us this.
Well, also, just in 1 year, didn't you have like a dozen billion-dollar-plus storms just in the United States, from hurricanes to tornadoes to major events?
The total is $100 billion between Hurricane Sandy and the drought that hit the United States, $100 billion. In infrastructure damage one way or another. You know, the thing is, this is the result of extreme weather patterns. These are not normalized weather patterns. You know, Hurricane Sandy happened outside of the hurricane season. How often do you get flooding in New York City and Wall Street? I mean, these things are extraordinary, out of the ordinary. That's what we're talking about with climate change. But unprecedented damage to infrastructure. We could go on. I've got a long list of studies that have been done about Alaska, where the infrastructure costs will go up $6 billion over the next 10, 20 years because of weather change. But we won't go into all those details, but it's a serious, costly matter.
Yeah, and so much for 100-year floods. They're now, what, every 10 years or less?
Well, yeah. And the one study claims that $1.2 trillion, this is a big number, is being wiped out of global GDP because of climate change infrastructure problems.
Scary.
That's a fairly large number.
That's a huge number. I mean, yeah. as Mansfield, yeah. Mike Mansfield used to say, a trillion here, a trillion there, only he said a billion. Pretty soon you're talking real money. What's number five on your list?
Well, number five is the splintering of nation states. And the U.S. military's already got the scent on this. They did a study called the National Security Implications of Climate Change for the U.S. Naval Forces. And that whole study focused on climate refugees migrating across borders because of the loss of their farmland or whatever it may be because of the all these things happening with climate change. Bangladesh is a great example. That's a splintering nation state because of land degradation, frequent storms, floods, and droughts. It's caused 12 million to 17 million people to leave and move into India. The result was a lot of these environmental migrants ran into extreme acts of violence when they got into India.
Yeah.
We've actually seen situations where these environmental migrants have caused nations to go to war. It happened between El Salvador and the Honduras in the 1960s.
Right.
So, you know, that's a serious problem. People have to move to where they've got access to water, to irrigation for their crops.
Yeah, and we have a couple of students that have worked on various projects here from UWC, Atlantic College, who are from Bangladesh, and they talk about these types of things going on in their nation state all the time. So it is indeed an issue. What's number four on your list?
The demise of capitalism. Now, there are some people that would say this is not a dreadful effect of climate change. That could be a bit controversial. However, I maintain that 90% of the population thinks this would be a dreadful effect. Listen, capitalism and a good, healthy climate don't seem to mesh very well because we've already got the example of this happening. Why do we have all of these gases going into the atmosphere uncontrolled without the proper parties paying the attention they should to? It's because, frankly, we've got rampant capitalism, especially in China. Naomi Klein, who wrote The Shock Doctrine, was interviewed by Bill Moyers a couple months ago. And she said, you know, we can't really leave everything to the free market. And she argues that the greatest free market failure is climate change. So the socialist collectivist groups in the world seem to do much better helping the climate than do the capitalist groups. And there's a good example of this in both Denmark and Germany. In Germany, they put up all of these wind farms, and they're community wind farms that are collectively owned by the residents in the area. That gives them a sense of ownership, and it seems to promote renewables much better than our capitalistic methodology. I think there's a major conflict between being in business purely for profit, which capitalism does, and profit at all cost, if you will, and the socialist collectivist concerns about the welfare of society. And that's where I see the demise of capitalism. Huge conflict, I think, between a clean climate and capitalism. We've already seen it happen.
Well, and there has to be a balance between the two somewhere along the line. And that's what's missing in the equation right now, is that it has been capitalism above everything else, and therefore no investment in what might obviously have an impact on capitalism, but would be beneficial for the planet as a whole. What's at number three, Robert?
Marine life extinction. And if you can imagine our planet without marine life, it's very possible, according to some of the best experts in the world on the oceans, that we may see it this century. What's happened here is the oceans have absorbed 30% of all the CO2 that's been spewed into the atmosphere since the start of the Industrial Revolution. And this problem with the CO2 or excessive CO2 in the oceans is that it inhibits calcium carbonate from helping marine life develop. This ocean acidification, and that's what it is, is 10 times worse today than at any time in history. As a result, scientists are already starting to see some of the results of this, of marine life extinction. For example, in Israel, off the coast of Israel, in the Mediterranean Sea, the scientists have found that the builders of the reefs have already gone extinct, and it's because of acidification. Another good example of this, and very importantly, pteropods. Pteropods are a free-swimming creature. It's like a tiny snail. They have got to have a shell to exist and move on in life. They're crucial to the marine food chain. They're eaten by everything from krill to whales. They're an important food source for salmon, mackerel, herring, cod. Scientists have already seen where their shells are weakening and not developing so that they can't mature properly. If we lose the pteropods, we lose the start of the food chain for marine life.
And yet there was an article just today talking about the crabs off the coast of Maryland that are located close to the hydro plants that are also taking in huge amounts, and their shells are actually, for some reason, getting stronger, and they're becoming major predators, and they're actually going out there and harming other fish. So it's definitely throwing the balance off everywhere. So where are we now with number two on your list?
Number two is loss of the world's glacial water towers. And let me just give you an example of a glacier in my backyard, and that's the Columbia Glacier, which is America's glacier. It flows into Prince William Sound in Alaska. It has retreated 13 miles up the fjord the last 30 years. Today, Dennis, it's shrinking at the rate of 50 feet a day. That's eight times faster than 30 years ago. So one of the things we're seeing here is this whole climate change thing is happening more rapid, the further along we go. Likewise, in the Andes in South America, they've taken photographs of the glaciers in the Andes in 1983 compared to them to today. Half the glaciers still remain.
Yeah, some stunning photos were out this week showing 25 years of loss, you know, and it was several miles worth of glacier, and it was just a shocking photo.
Oh, well, you know, the problem is this, though. You lose these glaciers, and the glaciers, especially in Asia and South America, According to the World Bank, 100 million people are at risk of losing their source of water, drinking water, for irrigation, for hydropower. Same thing in Asia, where you've got the third pole, which are all of those glaciers throughout the whole Tibetan plateau. Wow. The Chinese scientists have gone in and measured these things, and they're telling us that the glaciers are shrinking rapidly throughout the entire area. So you've got people that are going to lose. In India, India accounts 60% of their irrigation for their crops comes from glaciers. In China, 80% of their irrigation for their crops comes from glaciers. The rivers of the world are dependent upon glaciers. The Rhone River depends upon glaciers. And the glaciers are melting around the world, just plain and simple, flat out.
Stunning, stunning. Well, here we are. We've managed to reach the top of the list, the number one thing we need to fear.
Well, that's the flooding of coastal cities and island nations. Yeah. And frankly,
when we last talked, you said something about the fact that and this was a real shocker to me. I didn't think about it till you actually said it, that the Arctic is not really our concern because that's just water that's displaced by the ice. But all of this other melting is causing the problems, right?
Well, the big problems, the big ice sheets are Patagonia, Greenland, and Antarctica.
Yeah.
And the issue isn't really gradual melting that will cause the problem. The issue is if we reach what they call a tipping point. And I think on our one of our prior meetings, we talked about Dr. Richard Alley from Penn State, and he testified before Congress. What he told them was, if all of these glaciers and small ice caps melt, it will raise sea levels by 1 foot. But if great ice sheets go down 200 feet, and he did caution the members of Congress at that testimony that human-caused climate change could cause a tipping point to occur. These tipping points, what could cause one? Well, for example, an ice sheet collapse could cause it. And that's a distinct possibility right there in Antarctica.
Yeah.
Another thing that could cause it would be the thawing of the permafrost in Antarctica, or a change in the circulation of the North Atlantic Ocean currents. If one of these tipping points does occur, what I said in my article is it would be similar to the Titanic hitting the iceberg. After that, there's no stopping the consequences.
Right.
So if we were to get into a tipping point, this could all happen so rapidly, the world would be caught unaware and unarmed and not know what to do.
Well, absolutely terrifying stuff, Robert. And I thank you for taking essentially two segments here last week and this week to help explain to us what it is we're up against. Always great to have you on the program. As usual, you have scared me half to death, and I'm sure you've done a good job of frightening our audience as well. We've been speaking with Robert Hunsaker. He's an environmental journalist. He's a regular contributor here, and we're very grateful he's on our side. We need to listen to what he has to say. You're watching Worldview with Dennis Campbell. Stay right here.